I'm sure you have heard the words like unassailable, impregnable, and undefeated. Let me take you to a place which does justice to all those words. Today we are at the fort of Asirgarh, which is 20 kilometers north to the city of Burhanpur in Madhya Pradesh. It has an interesting history of its own. The interesting part about the fort is that it has been transferred through many dynasties but has never been conquered. The fort is built at three levels: Malaygarh, the lowest level, Kamargarh, the second level, and then the main fort, Asirgarh. It stands proudly at one of the highest peaks of the Satpura Ranges at a height of 701 meters above sea level. The walls of the fort add to the grandeur of the fort, which are 259 meters high. It is also very important geographically as it passes through the valleys of Tapti and Narmada, making it an important route for someone who had to go from northern part of India to the southern part. If a ruler had to conquer the southern part, having Asirgarh under his belt was almost compulsory. This is the reason it is also referred as Dakshin ka Darwaza or the door to Deccan. Once you cross these three levels, then you reach the first monument inside Asirgarh, the British prison, which earlier used to be a coin manufacturing unit during Akbar's reign. During the British rule, prisoners from many revolts, Kuka revolt of Punjab being the most prominent one, were held captive here and were later sentenced to death. The next monument you come across as you walk through the fort is the Rani Mahal, where the queen with her associates and servants resided. One interesting thing about Asirgarh is the place where we are walking right now is the terrace of the main fort. The fort is actually built underground, which adds to the security of this fort and the fact that it has never been defeated. The holes and the small windows you see are the roshandans, which were present for the light and air supply to the lower level of the fort. The next place you stumble upon is the recreational area built during the British rule, the squash court. This monument has British architecture written all over it. Next, we come across the living barracks built by the British for their army and their families. There are total 4 barracks in the fort, out of which 2 are no longer accessible. After the barracks, we take a long walk uphill, reaching the church and the priest's house built by the British. Alongside the house, there are stables where the horses rested. Next, you reach one of the most important monument of the fort, built during the Farooqi rule by Nasir Khan, the Jama Masjid. You will definitely feel small when you walk through the gigantic gates of the mosque. Before actual masjid, you come across more roshandans and drainage line, which we will discuss a little later. The architecture of the masjid is heavily influenced by Persian, Turkish and Mughal architecture. The huge arcs of the gate and pillars depict the prominent feature of Turkish and Mughal style of building. The Jama Masjid is the second highest point of the fort after the minars present in the masjid itself. The embroidery you find on the arcs of the windows and the jalis or marhabs which are left is the evidence of Persian and Turkish influence on the masjid. Many of the marhabs were taken back by the Britishers because of its beauty and the precision of the work. The minars are visible from every part of the city and there is no chance you can ever miss them. Earlier they were open to the visitors, but due to some mysterious events they were sealed off in 2010. After the masjid, you reach the first of the three lakes present in the fort, which formed the water system which was way ahead of its time, the Rani Talab. This was the place where female members came to take a bath and relax. The lake was surrounded by lavish and beautiful gardens with huge fountains which functioned without any modern technology. As you walk along these walls, you realize why this fort was never defeated. The high and the steep mountains acted as a natural security and the open ground right below made it impossible to attack from that side. As you cross the walls, you reach one of the scariest and the most gruesome part of the fort, the Fansighar. This was the place where people were hung to death and then were either thrown off in the Bawli just below the Fansighar or off the cliff. Next you reach the Topkhana, the place where cannon and the arms were kept.
There are five of these present in the fort, and the interesting part is the next Topkhana is visible from the previous one, and they could send messages directly to the person standing at the consequent Topkhana. These cannons were a nightmare for the forces trying to attack the fort. Next up, you reach the mysterious Shiva temple present here. Some say it was built in 1600s during Akbar's rule, but others believe it was built by Ashwatthama, the legendary character from Mahabharata. The dome of the temple had many paintings which depicted the story of this temple but are no longer available as they were destroyed due to rain. There is a bawli just beside the temple which also had a prison and one of the seven secret passages out of the fort.
There is one very interesting story about the fort. It is believed that when Ashwatthama was cursed by Lord Krishna during the Mahabharata, he built this temple to ask for forgiveness. Many people claim to have seen Ashwatthama roaming around the fort. They also believe that every morning he takes bath in the adjoining bawli and then offers fresh flowers and sindoor to the Shivling present at the Shiva temple.
Every morning when the gates of the temple are opened, people find fresh flowers and sindoor on the Shivling, which are believed to be offered by Ashwatthama in order to seek forgiveness from Lord Shiva. After the Shiva temple, you reach the second of the four living barracks built by the British. You will also come across the kitchen as you walk through this path. Next up, you have the second and the third lake of the water system of the fort, the Mama Bhanja Talab. These twin lakes, along with the Rani Talab and the pipes and drains which can be found all around the fort, made a water system which defied logic at that time. This water system successfully supplied water to every single part of the fort, which was situated at a level higher than the lake. There is a myth about the fort that if a Mama and a Bhanja go inside the lake together, only one of them comes out alive. After the twin lakes, we come to the last part of the fort, the British graveyard. This was built by the Britishers and holds the bodies of many British officials and families who lost their lives here. During the British rule, a plague hit the area and took lives of many children. There are some graves in which bodies of two children were buried due to shortage of space and huge number of deaths. This brings us to the end of the mysterious and the fascinating fort. Let us take a look at the timeline of the fort and hear about its history from an expert.
बुरहानपुर से लगभग 20 किलोमीटर की दूरी पर स्थित असीरगढ़ का दुर्ग अपनी अजेयता और दुर्गमता के लिए विख्यात है, जिसका निर्माण आसा अहीर ने 15वीं शताब्दी में करवाया था और इस पर क्रमशः फारूखी शासकों, मुगलों, मराठों में पेशवा होलकर तथा सिंधिया, उसके बाद अंग्रेजों का आधिपत्य रहा। किंतु इस दुर्ग की एक खास विशेषता यह रही है कि इस पर कभी भी समर के द्वारा, युद्ध के द्वारा अधिकार नहीं किया जा सका, बल्कि इसको जीतने के, इस पर अधिकार करने के लिए हमेशा छल कपट का ही सहारा लिया गया। उदाहरण के लिए देखें तो आसा अहीर से फारूखी शासक नासिर शाह ने कहा कि उसकी रानियां दुर्ग को देखना चाहती हैं। रानियों के डोले में सवार सैनिकों ने निकलकर धोखे से इस दुर्ग पर आधिपत्य कर लिया। इसी प्रकार अकबर के समय में इस पर अधिकार करने के लिए 11 माह तक घेरा डाले रखा गया, लेकिन उसमें सफलता न मिली। तब पुनः एक बार फिर छल कपट सहारा लेते हुए मुगल सैनिक संधि वार्ता के बहाने इस दुर्ग में घुसे और उन्होंने फारूखी शासक को कैद कर मीर बहादुर को कैद किया तथा छल पूर्वक फिर से इस पर अधिकार कर लिया गया। इसी प्रकार 1803 में जब मराठों से अंग्रेजों ने इस दुर्ग को छीना, तब भी केवल मात्र दिखावे के युद्ध में, जिसमें आश्चर्य की बात यह है कि मात्र 2 सैनिक मारे गए थे, उस युद्ध में इस दुर्ग पर अंग्रेजों ने अधिकार किया, जो स्पष्ट छल प्रपंच की नीति की ओर इंगित करता है। इसके बाद अंग्रेजों ने इस दुर्ग को एक तरह से अपना बंदीगृह बनाया और कूका विद्रोह के विद्रोही, अन्य विद्रोहों के विद्रोहियों को इसमें रखा गया। बाद में 1901 के बाद अंग्रेजों ने इसको अनकेयर छोड़ दिया और स्वतंत्रता मिलने के उपरांत भारतीय पुरातत्व सर्वेक्षण विभाग ने 1956 में अपने नियंत्रण में इसको लिया और तब से उसकी देखरेख और मरम्मत इत्यादि का कार्य बखूबी यह विभाग कर रहा है।
सो इन द एंड आई वुड लाइक टू कंक्लूड, इट वॉज नीदर द आर्किटेक्चर नॉर द फोर्ट विच अट्रैक्टेड मी टुवर्ड्स असीरगढ़, इट वॉज द स्टोरी दैट हिट मी। The anecdotes, the myths and the stories of the fort can stir you up from the inside. Its history is so fascinating and some of the myths and stories are so bizarre and sometimes scary even to think about, let alone believe them. In the end, I would like to say, I have been to this fort before, and if I get a chance, I will go again. Because still there are many stories to be told, many doors to be opened, many stones to be unturned, and many mysteries to be solved.